Good morning. Welcome back to the session on microwaves and antennas. Today we'll be doing horn antennas and regular horn antennas. The textbook is from John D. Cross. So coming to horn antennas, the definition of horn antenna, you can say that it can be a waveguide which is flared or opened out. The function of the horn is to produce a radiation pattern that has a uniform phase wavefront and also has a greater directivity. And this has a larger aperture than that of a waveguide. Remember, this waveguide has been flared out or opened out. So let us see what does it mean. Okay. As such, horn antennas are new, not new. They were constructed by Jagdish Chandra Bose somewhere in 1897 itself, the pyramidal horn. So these are the types of horn antennas. Okay, here we have two types of horn antennas. It is, one is rectangular horn antenna and circular horn antenna. In this case, we have certain arrows. The arrows indicate the E field directions, the electric field directions. How do you energize? You energize this from a rectangular waveguide. So this is your waveguide. And this waveguide is flared out. You can see that it has been flared out. The flaring out is in different planes and in different dimensions. Okay, so these are the rectangular wave horns where the waveguide is also a rectangular waveguide. And these are circular horns where the waveguide is a circular waveguide. And in the end also you get a circle. So these are the different types of horn antennas. And here we can observe that the horn antennas can have a gradual exponential taper or straight flares. So when I look at these figures, so here you can see that it is gradually flared or it is increased, it's opened up, or it can be a straight flare. You can see that in B, C, D, the flaring is straight. The opening up is straight. Whereas here you have a gradual exponential taper. So here also you, in this E, you have this exponentially tapered waveguide, whereas F, G, H, they're all having straight flares. So coming back to the definition of horn antenna, what is a horn antenna? It is a flared out or opened out waveguide. And the function of the horn antenna is to produce a uniform wave phase front with a larger aperture than that of a waveguide, so that you can have a greater directivity. And these are the different types of horn antennas. These are the different types of rectangular horn antennas. This is exponentially tapered and it is pyramidal also. This is D is also a pyramidal horn antenna, rectangular, but it is straight flare. A is again a pyramidal antenna, but with exponential taper. B and C are sectoral horn antennas. What do you mean by sectoral antennas? Sectoral antennas, I'll be telling in detail. Then conical antennas, circular horns. So here we have a conical and biconical antennas with the straight flares. E is exponentially tapered. So coming back, the region between the throat. This is a waveguide. This is the throat. And the other end is the opening or the aperture. So for the horn antenna, when we label the horn antenna, we have the following parts. Which are the following parts? One is the throat, then the aperture. In between the throat and the aperture, you have the horn antenna. This horn antenna has a transition region between the throat and aperture. This transition region is flared out. And this flaring out can be a gradual exponential taper. So you can see that this is a gradual exponential taper. So this will minimize the reflections of the guided wave. So whatever wave we have entering at the waveguide, from the aperture, it will be transmitted into the air. It will be radiated out into the air. So that reflection back into the source is minimized because of the horn region. This is a horn region or the transition region. Then coming to the next type of horns, we have sectoral horns. So these are rectangular horns with a flare in only one dimension. The opening is in only one dimension. You have a sectoral H plane, sectoral E plane. So this is a H plane sectoral horn. What do you mean by H plane sectoral horn? Assume that you are giving in Y direction the E. You're energizing E in the Y direction. So this is E is in the Y direction. The oscillation or is in the Y direction. So this is nothing but transverse electric mode 1-0. Now this is your, once again, your, these arrows indicate the direction of E. The E is in Y direction. So the E is in Y direction. But can you see the flaring out? So in the Y direction, the width is fixed. So in the Y direction, you can see that this width in Y direction is fixed. But whereas in the X direction, this is nothing but the particular in the plane perpendicular. So this is a plane perpendicular to the E direction. It can be in X or Z direction. You can see that there is a flaring out. So you're just seeing it's opening up. So instead of being straight, it is being opened up like this. It's flaring out. So this flaring out is in the direction which is perpendicular to E. And in this plane, we have the magnetic field H. So the flaring out or the opening. So this is your flaring out or opening or gradual expansion. The expansion of the antenna, the horn antenna, is in a plane perpendicular to E. E is in the Y direction and the flaring out is in a perpendicular direction. And that perpendicular direction field is nothing but the magnetic plane of magnetic field H. So this type of horn is known as H plane sectoral horn, because the flaring out, the opening is in H plane. The opening is in H plane. It is known as sectoral, H plane sectoral horn. This is H plane sectoral horn. So in Y direction, we have E. E is in the Y direction. And the flaring out is in the plane of the magnetic field H. The flaring out is in the magnetic field H. So hence, this is known as H-plane sectoral horn. Okay. Then we have the next type of horn, wherein once the flaring out is in the E field itself. So it is energized in the Y direction. This is your E. This is energized in the Y direction. And the flaring out also is in the same plane. So you can see that this X is fixed, but it is flaring out in the same plane, So it is known as E-plane sectoral horn. So you also have one more horn. Here it is known as a pyramidal horn. You have flaring out in both plates. So it is flaring out in X as well as in Y. So you can see that nothing is fixed. So this is also increased and this is also increased. So this area of aperture, this is the area of aperture is increased in both X and Y direction. So in the previous example, you could see that this is fixed, Y direction it is fixed, X direction it is flaring out. It is flaring out in the X direction. This is your aperture. And in your pyramidal horn, so you can see this. So here it is sectoral H plane. It is flaring out in this direction. This is fixed. In the sectoral E plane, this is fixed, X is fixed, Y is flaring out, Y has increased. Here X has increased. And in pyramidal, both of them have been flared out. This is flared out and this is flared out. So both the X, that is both the, this is your H plane. Instead of calling X, I'll call it as H plane. And this is your E plane. So it has been flared out in both the H plane and E plane. So this is E plane, this is H plane, and this is E plane. Okay, and now let us look at the electric field. Look at the electric field. You also see the direction and the magnitude. The magnitude is indicated by the length of the arrows. Okay, coming to the electric field. Remember, the electric field is in the y direction. The electric field is indicated by the arrow. You can see these arrows. The length of the arrows, the length of the arrows indicate the magnitude. It indicates the magnitude of the electric field. Now, when you look at this H plane, this is almost constant. The magnitude is almost constant. But when you look at the E plane or a sectoral E plane or the pyramidal, as you go towards the edges, you can see that the arrows have reduced in size. Similarly here, the middle at the center, you have a larger sized arrow, and towards the edges, the arrow size is small. Or the what does it indicate? It indicates the magnetic field is tapering to zero in the X direction across the aperture. So it tapers to zero. So the electric field, this is your electric field. The electric field is uniform in the Y direction. This is uniform in the Y direction, but what does it do? It tapers to zero. Okay, it tapers to zero as it comes to the edges. Okay, as it comes to the edges in the X direction. X direction is nothing but H. H field. In the H field, as it comes towards this, across the aperture. Then, okay, you can see this. This is what we have said. So this is suggested. You can see that there is a variation. So the waveguide is a magnitude in across aperture, but tapers to zero in the X direction across aperture. And the arrows indicate the direction of the electric field E, and the length of the arrows. So this is the length of the arrows that gives an approximate indication of the magnitude of the field intensity. And when you have a small flare angle, the field variation across the aperture is similar to that of a sinusoidal distribution of the waveguide. So what does it mean? When I look at this, here it is small, it increases and it decreases. So it's equivalent to the sinusoidal distribution of the TE10 mode across a waveguide. So this is your waveguide. So when you plot the magnitude, it is similar to this. Then we have the conical horn types, the conical horn antennas. And here we are excited with a circular waveguide. So this is your circular waveguide. You are exciting with a circular waveguide. And you have this electric field distribution at the aperture. So this is your electric field distribution across the aperture. At the center you have, and this is at the edges. Okay, this is at the edges. So this is a circular waveguide carrying a TE11 mode. And you have a circular waveguide, and you have an aperture, and you have a straight flaring out. You have a straight flaring out. Then this is a biconical horn antennas. These are the biconical antennas. They are excited by a vertical radiator. So you can see that this is your vertical head radiator. Previous cases, we had a horizontal radiator. Okay. Or you, instead of this, you can also have, instead of a vertical radiator, you can have one more antenna. That is, instead of this radiator, you can have a small loop antenna. This loop antenna can also energize this horn antenna. The horn antenna can be energized with a small loop antenna. And these biconical horns are non-directional in the horizontal plane. So they're radiated in, and so this is a previous example that we have seen of a monopole antenna. This is in your module one. When you have a stub antenna or monopole antenna, you, one of these variations is this, wherein you have a flaring out like this, D. This is your coaxial line. You're feeding it through this coaxial line, and you have a maximum radiation at the center. You have a maximum radiation at the center. Similarly, in this TE01 biconical antenna here, you can see that there is a maximum radiation at the center. And this is being fed by a vertical radiator. It is fed by a vertical radiator or a small horizontal loop antenna. Or a small horizontal loop antenna. So these are the conical antennas. So let us look at the radiation patterns of the horn antenna. So you can find the radiation pattern. So this is your radiation pattern at the aperture. For this, we should know the aperture dimensions. Okay. And for a given aperture, the directivity is maximum for a uniform distribution. If you have a uniform distribution, automatically the directivity is maximum. So if you have variations in the magnitude or phase of the field, see here you have certain variations in the magnitude, and we are assuming uniform phase, but even if the phase changes, the phase of the electric field changes across the aperture, they will decrease the directivity. So any antenna, we would like to have high directivity. So given any aperture, the directivity is maximum for a uniform distribution. The uniform distribution implies not only the magnitude is uniform across the aperture, the phase of the field, whether the electric field or magnetic field across the aperture is also uniform. But that is not possible. You have certain variations in the magnitude and phase of the field across the aperture, so that will decrease the directivity. Now, comparing H-plane sectoral horn and E-plane sectoral horn, in H-plane sectoral horn, you have a field distribution. So you can see this is the field distribution along the X dimensions. It will taper to zero at the edges of the aperture. And when you look at the pattern in the exit plane, this is relatively free of minor lobes. This we again show you later with figures. So in the H-plane, you can see that almost it is the same, only at the edges it will slightly taper to zero. So when you get a pattern, the radiation pattern, doesn't have minor lobes. This is what we require. The minor lobes and the back lobes should be zero. it should be zero. Only the major lobe should be there. So, whereas the YZ pattern in the E plane sector, for this E plane sector, you have the YZ pattern. And in this YZ pattern, the magnitude of E is constant in the Y dimension. This is what you're feeding. Okay. So then we also have the Fermat's principle. This is applicable to the horn design, but it's small difference. So we require generally a constant phase across the horn mode. This is your horn. This is being fed with a rectangular waveguide. This is length L, and this is a flaring out angle theta. And this is the horn mode. This is a plane of this. So here, this Fermat's principle says that you require a constant phase across a horn mode. But this requirement can be relaxed. And we can allow the phase to deviate slightly. And see, if at the center, you can see that it is there. But when it comes here to the end, so when it comes to the end, this is the plane of the horn mode. And when you come here, okay, you have a variation. So the variation of the phase may deviate because of the circular nature. The phase may deviate by a small amount delta. This is relaxed. This is a requirement. Okay, this is a requirement. And this requirement is relaxed. Generally, this delta should be zero. Delta should be zero for other antennas. But here, horn antenna, you can relax it. You can allow certain amount of delta. Okay, certain amount of delta. And how much is this delta equal to? It is equal to the path length difference between a ray traveling along the side and along the axis of the horn. What do you mean? You have a ray. Okay, let us say you have a ray of light, radiation. It travels like this. So when it travels at the center, so when it travels along the axis of this horn, it will travel a distance L. It will travel a distance L. But if it travels along the side, so if it is traveling along the side, it will travel a distance L plus delta. Okay, now what is the path difference? The path length difference between L and L plus delta is delta. And this amount of delta is allowed in the phase derived. This is relaxed. The phase may deviate. The phase may deviate by the amount delta. The phase may deviate by an amount delta. And what is delta here? The delta is the path length difference. Whereas Fermat's principle says that equality of path length. So in an antenna, you're talking about monopole design or whatever, you talk about equality of path length. But this is relaxed here. Okay, this relaxed here in the sense that you can allow a certain path length difference. You can allow a certain path length difference. And how much is this path length difference equal to? This path length difference is equal to delta. And how do you calculate delta? You calculate the distance traveled by a ray traveling along the side of the horn. A ray traveling along the side of the horn covers a distance L plus delta, and the ray along the axis covers a distance L. The difference between this L plus delta and L is delta. And this amount is allowed. Then we are coming about a pyramidal horn antenna. And this is a certain cross-section that we use in this pyramidal horn. This B portion gives the cross-section with the dimensions used in analysis. So this B portion can be either for E-plane. E-plane is in the Y direction, or it can be in the H-plane, which is in the X direction. The pyramidal horn is flared out. It's flared out both in X direction and Y direction. So X direction is H-plane. It is flared out in the H-plane as well as in the E-plane. It is being flared out in H-plane and E-plane. So when you consider any one of the cross-section, So you can consider the cross section in E, or you can consider the cross section H. So if you consider the cross section in let us say E, so it has once again L delta, then theta is the amount of flaring, L is a distance at the radial axis, and A is the aperture size. Here you have A. So for E plane, this theta becomes theta E. So for E plane, if this cross section is taken in the E plane, then the flare angle is theta E, and the aperture A becomes E. And if the same thing is taken in X direction, that's your H plane. For H plane, now the theta here becomes theta H, and the aperture here becomes AH. The aperture becomes AH. Okay, so this is the E plane cross section and H plane cross section shown separately. So it's the same pyramidal horn, and we take the section separately. And you can see here, this is a direction of E, this is the E plane cross section. It is traveling a distance R. Okay, this is a radius R, and that is nothing but L plus delta. And this is L is the length, L remains the same. L is the same both in E plane and H plane cross section, but the theta differs. Here you can have theta H in the H plane, and you can have theta E in the E plane. So the delta here also will be delta E. Okay, this delta depends on the amount of theta. Here also, here it will be R will be L plus delta H, and this delta H depends on theta H. The delta H depends on theta H, the amount of flaring. And the aperture size, you can see this aperture size. Here for H plane, it is AH. For E plane, it is AE. For E plane, it is AE. Look at the direction of E. E here is indicated by arrows like this, because this is in E plane, there's a Y plane, the E plane cross section is in the same plane. But whereas H plane, it is perpendicular. H is perpendicular. It is perpendicular to E plane. So it is represented like this. A circle with a dot. The arrow is mentioned like this. A circle with a dot. What is a circle with a dot here? Here also you can see the E fields. The E fields are represented with a circle with a solid dot. And it implies the E is, the arrow E is perpendicular to this plane. Okay, so E plane and H planes are perpendicular to each other. And when I'm looking at the electric field, the electric field is perpendicular to the H plane cross section. Going further, we have certain geometry to be derived. Okay, certain geometry to be derived. So let us look at theta here. Okay, let me look at this theta. So consider only this part, upper part of the triangle. So this will become theta by 2. So this is theta by 2. This is a total angle theta. So when I consider this triangle, I have like this. Okay, I have like this. So this angle becomes theta by 2. That angle becomes theta by 2. This distance is L. This distance is L. This is from the throat. And this is L plus delta. This is L plus delta. And what about this? This is your complete aperture. So I'm taking only one half of the aperture. So this becomes A by 2. So this becomes A by 2. So I'll clear it. So we are taking only one half of the triangle. Let us say we are taking this upper part of the triangle. So when I draw this upper part of the triangle, you have like this, okay? And here, this angle here will be half of this angle theta. So this will be a theta by 2. This will be theta by 2. And what about this length? This length will be L. This length will be L. And what about this length? This length will be L plus delta. Okay, L plus delta. And what about this? This will be a by 2. This will be a by 2. This is L plus delta. This is total distance. So you have a right angle triangle. So assuming this is a straight line, this is 90 degrees. So you can see these dotted lines. So this is 90 degrees. So when I have this cos theta by 2, this is the angle cos theta by 2. What is cos theta by 2? Adjacent angle divided by the hypotenuse. What is adjacent length, adjacent side? Adjacent side is L. Okay, adjacent side is L. What is the hypotenuse? It is L plus delta. Similarly, what is sine theta by 2? Sine theta by 2 is opposite side. Opposite side is A by 2. So this is theta by 2 and this opposite side is A by 2 divided by this L plus delta. That's your hypotenuse. If you take about tan theta by 2, what is tan theta by 2? It is opposite side, that is A by 2. A by 2 is together divided by the sine, that is L. So how do you get these equations? Cos theta by 2, you have to consider a right angle triangle. So this is the horn. Take the center line. So take the center line here. And then this is a right angle triangle. This is a right angle triangle. So this is 90 degrees. And this angle will be theta by 2. This is your theta by 2. And this length will be L plus delta. Can you see this? This is L plus delta. This length will be L. And this total length is A. The aperture is A. So when I'm taking only one half, this becomes A by 2. So this becomes A by 2. So what is cos theta? So this is cos theta by 2. This angle is cos theta by 2. This is side. Side is L. Okay, this is your L. L divided by the, this is a right angle triangle, L plus delta. Similarly, sine theta by 2. This is A by 2, opposite side divided by the hypotenuse. It is L plus delta 2, theta by 2. So L is a horn then, delta is a path difference, etc. Now let us derive further. So this is what we have seen. This is the E-plane cross-section and L-plane cross-section. So the theta E and theta H may vary. So if the theta E and theta H varies, if your theta E and theta H varies, even this R will vary and your AE will vary. Similarly, if theta H varies, the R will vary and AH will be varying. So this I'll call it as delta E, and this will be R will be L plus delta H. Now let us go further. Certain simplification. So what is this hypotenuse is equal to? Let us say I have an angle like this. Okay, let me call this as A. Let me call this as A, B, and C. What is C square equal to? C square is equal to A square plus B square. Remember this, this is a right angle triangle. So this is a right angle triangle. For a right angle triangle, what is C square equal to? C square is equal to A square plus B square. Now what is C here? C is L plus delta. That's your C. And what is A here? A is L square. And what is B? B is A by 2 whole square. Okay, or C is equal to square root of A square plus B square. Then expand this L plus delta the whole square and rearrange. And we can also assume that if this delta that is there is lesser than, if delta is lesser than L, delta square can be ignored. So you'll have only two terms. So you'll have only two terms. Which are the two terms? A square by 4 is equal to 2L delta. and put L on one side, A square, and the others on the other side. So you get L equal to A square plus 8 delta. This is simplified version. So in the textbook directly they have given L is equal to, in the textbook they have directly given L is equal to A square by 8 delta. So how do you get A square by delta? Take this triangle. Okay, take this triangle. C square is equal to A square plus B square. Substitute for C. C is L plus delta. This is C. C is L plus delta. A is this L square. And B here, this B is nothing but this A by 2. So this A by 2 whole square. Substitute it and ignore delta square. Delta is very small. Let us say 0.2. 0.2 square is 0.04, which is still lesser. So you can ignore delta. So finally you get L is equal to A square by 8 delta. Then what about theta? You can, theta can be calculated from any one of these equations. Suppose you use this equation. So what is theta? Theta is equal to, take the tan inverse to the other side, tan inverse of A by 2L. So this is theta by 2 is tan inverse by A by 2L. Bring the 2 to the other side. So you get 2 into tan inverse of A by 2L. Similarly, if I take this theta from this expression, cos theta by 2. Once again, theta by 2. What is theta by 2? Theta by 2 is nothing but cos inverse L by L plus delta. The 2 again, you bring it up. So it becomes 2 times cos inverse L by L plus delta. So this is a basic geometry. You have to remember these equations. Generally, this equation is 1. This equation is 2. So this is equation 1. This is 2. And this is 3. And this is 4 and 5 in the textbook. They are normally the same. Or you can use it either way. And what about the amount of delta? You're talking about delta. Okay, how much is the amount of delta? Delta is generally 0.25 lambda and less, provided your L, A are all at least 1 lambda and above. Okay, they are greater than 1 lambda and above. If the length L, A and all are 1 lambda and above, 1 wavelength and above, then your delta is generally 0.25 and less. Generally, remember, we are making an exception here. We are allowing delta, that is the path length difference because of the flaring out of the horn antenna. And the delta in the E-plane of the horn is generally 0.25 lambda or less. And in a H-plane, delta can be larger. This is because this is your sectoral horn. This is sectoral E-plane. When you look at the sectoral H-plane, okay, you can see that E is almost constant. Only at the horn edges you can have. So the delta can be larger. It can go up to 0.4 delta. So what about delta in the E plane? In the E plane, the delta is 0.25 lambda and above. Whereas in H plane, that is H plane sectoral one, you can go up to 0.4 lambda. So if you have to have a uniform distribution for the aperture, you need a very long horn with a small flare angle. But the horn should be as short as possible because your antenna should be compact. So when you look at the practical convenience, the horn should be as short as possible. So when you look at this optimum horn, when I'm talking about an optimum horn, it should be between these two extremes. One extreme is I need a uniform phase distribution. For this, I need a uniform aperture. For this, I require a very long horn with a very small flare angle. Okay, but from practical convenience, the horn should be as short as possible. So this optimum horn, which is in between these extremes, will have the minimum beam width. So the beam width will be minimum so that the directivity is great. The beam width is less and the side lobe level, the side lobes also should be less. The side lobe and generally it is tending to zero is very good. Or you can, that implies that the directivity or gain is very high. The directivity or gain is high. So what are the requirements? The requirements are you need a uniform aperture distribution. For this uniform aperture distribution, the horn will be generally a very long horn with a small flare angle. The theta will be very small. But for practical horns, we need it to be as short as possible. So you get an optimum horn, which has a minimum beam width. So the beam width, HP half power beam widths are all minimum. And what about the side lobes? The side lobes also should be zero, almost zero. And so that the gain or the directivity is higher for a given length, for a given length. Next, coming to delta, as we have already seen, delta should be a sufficiently small fraction of a wavelength. So if delta is small, then you get uniform phase distribution, uniform phase over the entire aperture. Let us say that the length is fixed. You have a constant length L, and we need a high directivity. So when you get a high directivity or lower beam width, this is happening when the flare angle theta and aperture A are increased. But if you increase the flare angle, what will happen to delta? Delta may become 180 degrees and at the edge of the aperture, and the phase becomes in opposition to this. So what is delta? Delta should be zero. Delta is to be zero means constant phase is maintained. That is uniform phase. But if delta becomes 180 degrees, so this uniform phase plus 180 degree ensures that the electric field at the edge of the aperture has a 180 degree phase shift. 180 degree phase shift means the positive one will become negative, etc. So you get a phase opposition to the field on the axis. So generally you avoid this. So for almost all flare angles, we have what is known as a ratio, axial, the ratio L by L plus delta is nearly unity. What does this L by L plus delta is nearly unity imply? It implies that delta is small. Okay, delta is so small that the effect of additional path length delta on the distribution field magnitude can be neglected. This is a general statement. So what about delta? Delta should be a small fraction of the wavelength, and that means the field is nearly uniform. But what happens, what is the requirement? For a constant length L, we need a higher directivity. Higher directivity means higher gain. If you have to increase the directivity or the gain, that implies the beam width should decrease. But of course, how do you decrease the beam width or increase the directivity of the horn? You have to increase the aperture. So you have to increase the aperture. So this is the one. You have to increase the aperture size. So L is constant. L is constant. So you have to increase the aperture. Aperture is this A. So this is your A. If the aperture A has to be increased, what does it mean? It means that the theta that you have here, the flare angle theta should be increased. What happens if this theta increases? If this theta increases, aperture A is increasing, theta A increasing. So what happens to the directivity or the gain? Gain also increases. But if you increase this theta, what will happen to L plus delta? Here delta also increases. Remember, delta also increases. Remember, you kept L constant. Okay, you kept L constant. So what is its effect? If you are increasing theta, delta is increasing. And if delta becomes so large, okay, if the flare angle theta is so large, the delta also increases, and delta becomes 180 degrees. Then what will happen? The field at the edge of the aperture. So you have an electric field here at the edge of the aperture. How is the electric field? Electric field is like this. Since delta has increased here, this field has a phase difference. And if this phase difference becomes 180 degrees, you get phase opposition. So this field and this field will be in, this edge and that edge will be in opposition, phase opposition. So you avoid it. Generally, you have this L plus delta. The delta is so small. Okay, the delta is so small. So the delta is so small when you compare to L. When the delta is so small when compared to L, L by L plus delta is nearly unity. So the additional path length effect can be neglected. So how do you make, though L is constant, choose L to be so large. Delta is nearly negligible. L by L plus delta is nearly unity. And the effect of this additional path can be done. So this is one more consideration. The next is, as we have seen in the previous case, when delta is 180 degrees, the phase reversal, it reduces the directivity. What happens when you get a phase reversal? We are increasing theta such that we are getting higher directivity. But because of this delta equal to 180 degrees, you have a phase reversal. And because of this phase reversals, you have side lobes. And once you have the side lobes, once again, the directivity reduces. So we are looking at the maximum directivity. This occurs at the largest flare angle for which delta does not exceed a certain value, delta naught. So you fix an angle delta naught. And at this delta naught, so your theta here, okay, your theta here, the largest flare angle, you can't simply exceed, you fix it, a cap on this, the cap that is such that it does not exceed delta naught. And how do you get the optimum horn dimensions? One is optimum length. So we have seen how the length L plays an important part. And the second is optimum delta. If delta is zero, what will happen? It will be like this. Aperture A is zero. So you increase delta. A increases. The directivity or the gain D also increases. But if delta becomes 180, you have phase reversal, then the side lobe increases. And so you're still increasing delta. But the D starts decreasing. Because of the phase reversal of the electric field. So you can't increase delta beyond a certain point. And that certain point is given by delta naught. And this delta naught is known as optimum delta. And how do you find this optimum delta naught? So the optimum delta naught is given by the empirical relationship. Delta naught is equal to L by cos theta by 2 minus L. So this is your optimum delta. Again, take common denominator. Take this equation. Take the common denominator. You get L minus L cos theta by 2. Then cross multiply here. So you get delta naught into cos theta by 2. Numerator, you have L minus L cos theta by 2. This is your numerator. Take out L common. You have 1 minus cos theta by 2 here. On the other side, you have this cross multiplication. So you have delta naught cos theta by 2. Then bring this to the denominator. And keep L on one side. So you have the expression of L. So from this equation only, you rearrange this equation so that you get L on one side, the rest of the terms on other side. So that gives you the expression for optimum length. So whenever you're talking about optimum horn dimensions, you can fix up delta naught. Okay, you can fix up delta naught. And from delta naught, you can get the length L. Or otherwise, the other way around, if L is given as something like 10 lambda, okay, if L is given as 10 lambda, for this 10 lambda, you can find delta naught. Okay, or L is equal to 5 lambda, 8 lambda. So the length of the horn is fixed. So even in that case, you can find your optimum delta. The other way around, delta naught is given, you can also find L. either way, the same equations. So further, they already found out that the value of delta naught should be in the range of 0.1 to 0.4 lambda. So delta naught should be either 0.1 lambda minimum, maximum it can go up to 0.4 lambda. So for an optimum horn, if you have L is equal to 10 lambda, as I said, delta naught is something like 0.25 lambda, or the other way around. If you fix delta naught as 0.25 lambda, the axial length that I get, L is equal to 10 lambda. For this, how much is the theta? How much is the theta flare angle that I get? So you have the expression of theta that we have seen in the last slide. Theta is equal to 2 tan inverse A by 2L. So A is substituted. Okay, A is substituted. Or you can use this expression, or you can use the tan expression or the cos expression. Anyway, so here I have, if I use this cos expression, I have L. L is 10 lambda. Divided by 10 lambda plus 0.25, delta value is also given. So delta value is 0.25 lambda. So lambda gets cancelled. Numerator I have 10. Denominator I have 10 plus 0.25. Take the cos inverse and multiply. You get theta is equal to 25 degrees. So what does this flare angle give you? This flare angle theta gives you the maximum directivity for a 10 lambda horn. So the length of the horn is L equal to 10 lambda. What's the maximum angle? 25 degree gives you the maximum directivity. So this path length effect, or the delta effect, as you see, it's an inherent limitation of all horn antennas. So whichever horn antenna that you're talking about have these limitations. Okay, what does this slide tell you? This slide tells you about the effect of delta naught. Generally, delta naught is fixed between 0.1 to 0.4. You don't have the option of delta naught equal to 0. If you have delta naught equal to 0, what does it mean? It means that the theta is 0. Theta is 0. It's not a horn antenna. It becomes a mono, the stub antenna. It becomes a stub antenna. So you can, delta also cannot be too large. So the minimum, it can be around 0.1 lambda, and it can go up to 0.4 lambda. Suppose you have chosen for an optimum horn delta naught as 0.25 lambda, and you have also chosen the axial length as L equal to 10 lambda. In this case, you can find out theta, the flare angle, as 25 degrees. So use this equation, theta is equal to 2 cos inverse L by L plus delta. You get theta equal to 20 degrees. So what does this mean? It means that this is a flare angle, the theta of 25 degrees. It gives you a horn with a length of 10 lambda, and you get a maximum directivity of this. You can also change this L equal from 10 lambda to 8 lambda, 4 lambda, etc. The lengths, automatically the flare angle also changes for this maximum directivity. You can keep this delta naught constant at 0.25 lambda, change the length L, your theta also varies, such that you get the maximum directivity. Get the maximum directivity. So, but the appropriate value of delta naught, it also differs depending on the type of horn antenna, whether you're taking the E sectoral horn, the H sectoral horn, the pyramidal horn, conical horn. Okay, depending on the type of horns, the appropriate values. Previous example, we just said the value of delta naught can be in a range of 0.1 to 0.4 lambda. It can vary from 0.1 lambda to 0.4 lambda, and we had taken an example of 0.25 lambda. So back this appropriate value of delta naught, it will vary. Okay. The, apart from this limitation, you also have to, in most of the horn antennas, for uniform aperture illumination, higher modes of transmission in the horn must be suppressed. So this is transmission mode, this is axial mode, or whatever you have. The higher modes of the transmission, higher modes of transmission has to be suppressed. So if you have to suppress, the aperture size should be limited. Okay. So what happens if, I'll just give you an example. So this is T0, then you have something like this. So this radiation is T01. Suppose you have like this. Okay, it is T, and these are all higher modes. T21, etc. All these are higher modes. So these higher modes will be suppressed. So one common factor of all these higher modes is, if these modes have to be transmitted, or radiated into the air, the aperture size, okay, this is your aperture size, the aperture size should be larger. If the aperture size is higher, the higher modes of transmission are suppressed. That's a simple solution. But coming to the aperture size, the width of the waveguide at the throat is, so this is a waveguide. So when I consider the waveguide, this is the throat. Okay, at the throat you have between lambda by 2 and 1 lambda. At the throat you have lambda by 2. And if it is so, the width also should also be, and the, not only the higher modes, even the even modes are to be suppressed. And then the width must be between lambda by 2 and 3 lambda by 2. So as I said, how do you suppress this? By reducing the aperture size. And if you have to reduce the aperture size, even the width of the waveguide, at the starting of this, where these illumination is there, it has to be there, that also has to be reduced. And that is generally between, that will be generally between a lambda by 2 and 1 lambda. And you can also go slightly little higher, but you generally have a lower width so that the higher modes of transmission are suppressed. So the next topic that we are talking about is a rectangular horn antenna. The next topic that we are talking about is rectangular horn antenna. So before we go for this, let us recap what we have done today. Okay. So today we were talking about the horn antennas. So we had given the definition of a horn antenna as a flared out or opened out waveguide. So what is a horn antenna? Horn antenna is a flared or opened out waveguide. And there are many types of horn antennas. These are rectangular horn antennas and these are circular horn antennas. So what about the labeling of a horn antenna? The horn antenna consists of a throat. At the throat, you feed the signal through a waveguide. The waveguide can be a rectangular waveguide for rectangular horns, and for circular horns it can be a circular guide. Then you have the aperture at the other end, at the other extreme you have the aperture of the horn. So this is the aperture. In between the throat and the aperture, this flared out portion or the transition region is known as a horn. So this horn can be either a gradual exponential taper, this can be a gradual exponential taper, or it can be a straight taper. So in all the other examples, it is straight taper. Okay, the flare is in a straight direction. So if you have an exponential taper, if you have a gradual exponential taper, this is quite good. It will minimize the reflections of the guided wave. So the wave that comes out of this aperture, the amount that is reflected back into your transmission line becomes less. Then the other type of horns under rectangular horns, we have sectoral horns. The sectoral horns can have a flare in only one dimension, such as sectoral H-plane. So in sectoral H-plane, let us assume that the electric field that you're giving is the T10 electric mode. That is it. So the electric field is only in the Y direction. Now, if the flare is in the X direction is perpendicular to the Y direction, the X plane is also known as a H plane or the magnetic field plane. Remember, the electric field and the magnetic field are perpendicular to each other and they propagate in the Z direction. So this is your electromagnetic EM waves. So EM wave consists of an electric field component, a magnetic field component. Let us say the electric field component is in the y direction. The magnetic field will be in the x direction and will be propagating in the z direction. So when you're constructing the horn antenna, if the electric field that you're energizing is in the y direction and you're flaring it out, you're opening it out in the x direction by keeping the y constant. So you can see this y width is constant, but the x width is going. It is H-plane sectoral horn. And similarly, you have the E-plane sectoral horn in the y direction only if you flare out. You're flaring out in the y direction, it is sectoral E-plane. And if you flare it out in both directions, in x as well as y, it is known as pyramidal. And here you can see that the magnetic field is, the electric field is given by the arrows. The size of the arrows gives you, the length of the arrows gives you the strength of the electric field. The magnitude of the electric field or the strength of the magnetic field is given by the size of this. And you can see that this tapers to zero near the apertures as it goes near, but it will have a sinusoidal variation. So these are about the different types of flaring out in the rectangular horns. Then coming to the conical ones, we also have the distribution of electric field here. And there are two types, conical and biconical. This is conical. And then you have biconical. Biconical is non-directional. And you have maximum radiation here for this T01. And they are being fed by a vertical radiator, or they can be energized by a loop antenna. And then we also have the directivity and this. Okay, then we have certain derivations. Okay, we have theta as a flare angle. Theta is a flare angle. It tells you how much it flares out. If theta is increasing, it flares out in a greater way. And your A, the aperture size increases. The aperture size increases. What about delta? Delta is a path length. Even path length increases as theta increases, A increases and delta increases. But for most of the antennas, we have this Fermat's principle, according to which you need equality of the path. If you have various rays, one traveling in the axial direction, another through the edges, all of them should travel equal path length, but that is slightly relaxed here. Instead of equal path length, they can also travel L plus delta. And these are the derivations of the flare length, cos theta by 2 in terms of L and L plus delta. You can either express it in terms of sine or cos. And L also, you can express it in terms of the aperture A and delta. I mean, theta also you can express in terms of A and L or L and L plus delta. So this is about how much is delta. Delta can be 0.25 lambda or less in the E plane of the horn. But if you are having a pyramidal one, you have delta both in the E plane and H plane. In the E plane, delta is in E plane, you have to be very careful. It should be 0.25 lambda or less. In the H-plane, you can slightly relax. It can be going up to 0.4 lambda because H is perpendicular to the E-plane and the E goes to zero at the horn edges. Okay, and you are talking about an optimum horn. So for an optimum horn, assuming a constant length L, you find out the optimum horn dimensions as delta naught. Your delta shouldn't go up to 180 degrees. If you keep increasing delta, your gain, whatever gain that you have made in the directivity suddenly starts decreasing. So you have an optimum value delta naught. And from that, you can also have an optimum length. That gives you the optimum horn dimensions. And we also have seen that how you have to suppress the higher modes of transmission in the horn. For this, you have to fix up the width of the waveguide at the throat to something between lambda by 2 and lambda. So the next class, we'll be talking about rectangular horn antenna. So thank you.